Graeme's case, this is far from true. I know many of you will find this hard to believe, that Graeme was a quiet, sensitive child with impeccable behaviour. He was a pious boy, and for 10 years he recorded a perfect attendance at the St David's Sunday School at Cooey. During his childhood, he was never heard to utter one obscene word. Well, not in front of his sisters, and definitely not in front of his mother. While growing up, did Graeme display any of the characteristics he later exhibited? No. Was he naturally funny? No. Did he display any theatrical aptitude? No. But his siblings did. They all landed starring roles in the annual school concerts at the Cooey Memorial Hall. Graeme's only acting credit was as a very underwhelming third rat from the right in a production of The Pied Piper. Was he constantly scheming and planning? No. He was enjoying his idyllic childhood. With the beach at his back door, there was swimming, body surfing and all types of fishing, with drag netting at the bottom beach a particular favourite. Cooey also had the right type of hill for tobogganing. The fact that Cooey is not known for snow did not deter the Cooey kids. With sheets of Bernie board smeared with dripping from the Sunday roast, the grassy slope provided a frightening, adrenaline-charged rush and hours of fun. But something did change, though, when Graeme commenced his education at Bernie High School. He found that he could make people laugh, and he adored the attention and the adulation. School reports were now noting that he was the class clown. Our Tarung Street neighbour shared the story of attending a party with Graeme in the 1960s. Graeme was hilarious, and he held the floor for hours, telling joke after joke and singing dirty ditties. Every time he required a fresh beer, he would stand on his head against a wall, and in that upside-down position, he would scull the entire glass without spilling a drop. Graeme was the life and soul of many a party, honing his skills for his entrance into a theatrical world. From his childhood days, Graeme did learn many valuable lessons, instilled in him by our parents, Ray and Joyce. Maureen, Brian, Graeme, Patsy and Barbara Paine, and from 1961, Pat Sterling, all learned about loyalty and the importance of family. We were taught a strong work ethic, as our parents believed that if a job was worth doing, it was worth doing properly. And they promoted the notion that you should be of service to your community. During his life, Graeme embraced their principles. In the words of one of Graeme's iconic characters, Alf, "We are really, really going to Malfis the Belfasted."
Thank you. Thank you, Maureen and Ben. The wonderful Christina will now share her thoughts on Graeme, life, love and laughter, supported by the equally wonderful Bianca, and Zeb is going to spot for the journey up the stairs.
first met Graeme when I was 22 and he was 30 at a suitably wild party. He was proud of being 30 and I told him that was too old to be at that sort of party. I moved to Melbourne, but we never really forgot each other. 2 years later, I returned and I decided a hobby in theatre might be for me. I went to a uni review audition, having already checked out who the director was. I must say, when I walked into that audition, I would never have envisaged this. I was in that review, Pro Rogues Gallery, and we dated almost immediately. It turns out another cast member had asked Graeme for my phone number, and Graeme, being the cheeky bugger he was, instead gave them Pat Harrison's. Sorry. He kept mine all for himself. Early dating during that review, we went to Launceston. He always called into his parents' house at Ross, telling them he was bringing a passenger. They knew nothing about me, and when his mother came out to meet him, she exclaimed, "I wasn't expecting a girl. I thought it was going to be Paul Bennett." Right, when we were dating, the Black Theatre of Prague was on at the Theatre Royal. I mentioned this in passing, that I was going along with a friend. During the play, I looked up the row about five seats and there he was. "Fancy seeing you here." It wasn't too long before I married the director, who I often laughingly called Mr. Showbiz. 8 years later, we had five children. He was my best friend and kindred spirit, making a profound difference to my life. I was blessed the day I met Graeme, and we were always on the same page. We always knew what each other was, often knew what each other was thinking without any discussion. Married in 1983, we moved to Poets Road, West Hobart, where we lived for 27 years. I'd like to offer a tribute to our friend and neighbour, Bette Anderson, who during the last 2 years, I know lots of other people were brilliantly kind too, would help me take him out, and to, including two family weddings. With his quick wit and mischief, he would always make me laugh. Some quick stories. Outside a men's toilet at Rest Point one night, he was standing next to Robin Gray, the Premier at that time. He turned around and said, "So this is where the big knobs hang out." We were in a market in Fremantle, and I fell in love with a pair of fake leopard skin Ugg boots. As I was buying, standing behind me, I hear, "How do you get a leopard to root a sheep?" I couldn't believe what I was hearing. I was often apologising for his behaviour with us. We were lining up at Circular Quay one trip to Sydney to inquire about climbing the Sydney Harbour Bridge. I asked, "How much does this cost?" Answer, $200 each. Standing right behind me, once again I hear, "I could think of cheaper ways to shit myself." Once again. Once again, I couldn't believe my ears. He was full of mischief. During those years raising our children, he was so proud of them. We never discussed starting a family. We always knew we wanted to expand our love with children. Perhaps something he lived to regret years later, when he would say, "I don't believe where I went wrong. I've got children who don't do as they're told and a wife who thinks she's an American teenager." He was playful. One day when I was at home with the children in his work lunch break, he came running down the steps with a brown paper... with a brown paper bag in his hand. I thought, "Goody! He's brought my favourite pastries as a treat." How disappointed was I when he said, "I shit my undies at work and had to bring them home." those days I worked and we would arrange to meet places after work, always on foot. He would plan to arrive on the way knowing the route I would take. He would arrive earlier, off the footpath he would hide and jump out at me. As our children grew up, we had a joke that if he did another review, I'd have another baby. He won. I probably would have had 14 babies. He would always run his embryonic ideas past me, whether it be for summer school, funny bits or review. I was his sounding board, his biggest fan, and believed he was one clever, quick-witted, inventive man. We were so proud when he received the OAM. I felt so honoured to be married to a Kiwi boy who'd achieved that. He was unassuming and never changed. The room at Mac 1 dedicated to movers and shakers was another time we glowed with pride. He was beyond proud of his children. They were his world. He involved himself in their things and brought them into his theatre, including Uni Review, from very young ages. Throughout our relationship, he was a great leveller. When I had a problem, he would always put it in perspective. He was very good at that. In 2014, I decided to go to university for 4 years. He supported me all the way, brilliant at editing assignments with his red pen of death. Graeme was skilled at grammar and editing, not bad for a boy that failed composition at high school. We spent hours reading my work, and never once did he display a sign of impatience. In 2015, he was diagnosed with the brutal progressive supranuclear palsy. I knew that would be the most challenging years our lives would ever face. His great strength and courage was always apparent, as he knew what was ahead while he was robbed of the ability to participate in the activities he loved, including his other passion, playing bowls. As his life was eroded away, he and I made some very difficult decisions regarding the final stages and dying. He was so brave. My kindred spirit is gone, but I will never forget in the 40 years we knew each other, how humble he was and motivated he was by the love of people, especially our futures. God bless you, Graeme. Now you are free. I'll tell his grandchildren that their Poppy is now a bright star in the sky.
Thank you, Christina and Bianca. Absolutely wonderful words from start to finish. Daryl Peebles will now share his reflections on Graeme's contributions to Tasmanian theatre. And here he is, ever the showman, Daryl Peebles.
Doesn't quite cut it, does it? This is as close as I had in my wardrobe to painting his famous yellow check jacket. What do you reckon?
No. Oh, no, bugger it.
Look, generally, ladies and gentlemen, I tend to avoid funerals because at my age, I'm scared that I'll be the stupid bastard who catches the wreath. And I'd like to start by acknowledging the fact that Richard Sneer ruined my life. It's true, Richard Sneer, alias Dick Trapp, to his friends, an old Nick life member, introduced me to Paine in 1978, and the decline began. Trapp and I both worked at the ABC, where I had a bit of a reputation for penning silly songs and doggerel and other such. And he thought I might be a bit of a, I don't know, might be able to do this for the annual university review. And he mentioned it to Paine, and Paine's response was, well, give him my number and have him give me a call, because you've got to remember those days we had to pay for our own local calls. So I did, and I thought that by being the director of an esteemed theatrical company such as Old Nick, I would have to pay him some respect, you know. This bloke might have some status, some high standing in our society. So I called and I respectfully asked for Mr. Paine. And that's when I heard one of Paine's now famous lines, "That's me." So he invited me to come up to his home in Lansdowne Crescent the following day and we'd look at some ideas, but before he hung up, he clearly stated his selection criteria for this coveted position as a University Review scriptwriter. "Just so you know," he said, "you bring the beers." Now, this was a time when Malcolm Fraser was our Prime Minister. He was on the nose a bit to most thinking Australians, and this was way before Malcolm saw the light, renounced his party affiliations and became a decent human being. And I thought a good thought-provoking title for the review would be a play on the PM's name, something like malpractice, maladjusted, malformed, maybe malarkey even. Whatever, but Paine said, "No, mate, too bloody intellectual. Lesson number one, review audiences are the lowest common denominator." "Bloody moon of mums, mate, reading age of about 8. They need something they can recognise, something they can relate to." And about that time in the cinemas, Superman the movie was the big hit. So we came up with Supermal the Review. And that's where that was born. And also was born a 43-year friendship that I really, really cherish. The second lesson I learnt from Paine was that any publicity is good publicity. For example, the second review was called By Elections. By was spelled B-U-Y. This was back in 1980, and the inference then was that elections in Tasmania could be bought for the right price. And nothing has changed, has it? Just ask the federal group and the current mob. Anyway, By Elections was motivated by the 1979 Tasmanian state election, which had been sullied by some elected members not acting really honestly with their spending limits, etc. We didn't have to write much of a script because the politicians did it for us simply by displaying their own stupidity. And a Scotsman named Bill McKinnon, who had lost his seat in that election, decided to sue Michael Aird from his own party, mind you. And this cascaded into more lawsuits and countersuits, and it was just bloody hilarious, with no less than 3 sitting members actually losing their seats and being turfed out. So when we staged By Elections, we portrayed Bill McKinnon as a Scottish twit. Beautifully played by Marcus Bauer, another Old Nick Life member who is no longer with us, and at that time president of the Old Nick Committee, Bill was incensed. After the show on opening night, he stormed into the Theatre Royal Hotel demanding to know who was responsible for this perceived character assassination. He recognised Marcus, who had played him on stage here, and targeted him initially. Marcus pointed to Paine and said, "He's the director." Paine, bless him, pointed to me and said, "He wrote it." So I bought Bill McKinnon a whiskey. He settled down a bit. Now, what's this got to do with publicity, I hear you ask? Well, Paine thought that by settling Bill McKinnon down, it was a retrograde step. He said, "Let the bastard sue us. It'll make him look sillier, and besides, we need a little publicity." It didn't work. Anyway, move on a few years and a change of government, and Peter Hodgman was the Minister for Tourism. There was a scandal at the time because there was a tourism brochure printed at great expense to the taxpayers of Tasmania, but they'd forgot to put the obligatory photo of the minister in the brochure. Hodgman had them all recalled, trashed, shredded, and reprinted with his photo in it. Now, this happened to be about the time of a review, so we got our programme that year printed with Peter Hodgman's photo on every bloody page. We then issued a media release announcing the fact, and we claimed that unlike the government, we couldn't afford the wastage. And the media was all over the story like a bad suit. The minister was very pissed off, and our ticket sales rocketed. The power of publicity. And of course, if there was nothing to hang your publicity hat on, you could always invent something. Like Paine, he's claimed that he drove his old itchy pussy man to a review rehearsal one year with a cat on the roof. Remember that? Now, I'm pretty sure there may have been a cat on board when Paine got into the Mitsubishi. I doubt it lasted more than a couple of metres. But why waste a good publicity stunt for the want of a few exaggerated facts, eh? It made the newspaper, ticket sales rocketed. Uni Review and Graeme Paine were synonymous. Let's face it, they were both born in the same year, 1948. And although Review was Paine's initial passion, he was also instrumental in a lot of other shows on stage all around Tasmania. He played the lead male role of McMurphy in the local production of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest in the early 80s. He was in the first Tasmanian production of Jack Hibbard's Dimboola, and more recently things like Brassed Off, as well as stage versions of the popular British TV comedies such as The Vicar of Dibley and Allo Allo, both here in Hobart and up in Launceston. Now, as good an actor as Paine may have been, he occasionally slipped out of character. And the real Graeme Paine shone through. Andrew Coleraine, Colza, loves to tell the story that when he and Graeme were playing the German soldiers, Colonel von Strum and Lieutenant Gluber in the 2001 Exit Left production of Allo Allo, Paine's line when expressing concern about his hairpiece was supposed to be, "Watch my viglet?" But on one night when Graeme was a bit too relaxed, it came out as, "Mind me bloody wig." In the broadest Aussie ochre accent you could ever imagine. And he was also instrumental in starting other Tasmanian theatre endeavours that are now anticipated as part of our annual theatrical event calendars down here. These included the Old Nick Summer School that's been already mentioned, and the Bawdy Panto. Now, the next one of these, Brian the Bitch in the Bathrobe, will be on this very stage in under just 6 weeks. It's publicity, baby! He also appeared in all the Ramp and Bear Theatre restaurant shows that Graeme Richards and I used to produce. He loved touring shows, and in later years he produced the Best of Review and Funny Bits shows in town halls and clubs all around the state. These featured many ex-Old Nickers as cast members, including John Eyre, Andrew Coleraine, Christy Lee Ransley, Spot Cohen, Fran Armstrong, Andrew Casey, Karen Joyce, the list goes on. And later were joined by his own kids, Ben, Nick and Imogen, all joining the throng of the Old Nick ex-cast members doing those tours. Christy Lee, or Springer as she's better known, remembers Paine always beeping the horn as they went over Spring Hill, or indeed whenever he passed a paddock with a flock of sheep near the fence, just to scare the sheep. I mean, what's this thing about sheep and bloody leopards, mate? And how he would get unusually excited about buying mutney from the Charket at Epping Forest. Now, of course, those of you quick enough would know mutney from the Charket was, of course, chutney from the market, because Paine loved spoonerisms. And he and I often laughed about forming a dance troupe, which we planned on calling... It was going to be one bloke and a bevy of busty girls in our dance troupe, and we were going to call it Fred Tobley and the Tobley Wits. And it's a pity we never got to stage that before political correctness determined that we could never get away with it. As Springer also recounted how Paine had slightly devious influence on the kids backstage during those country funny bit shows. I'm going to quote from something she wrote for us. "We'd be out in the back kitchen waiting to come on and feeling a touch peckish. Graeme was a master of stealing sandwiches out of Tupperware containers or off paper plates and giving them a bit of a shake to resettle the sanger so nobody could tell that there were any missing." Springer also mentioned he loved the sponsor's product, which of course was Bogues. But I must add here that Paine didn't drink as much in later years as he did when we first met. This was mainly due to a nasty PFO incident at Lloyd's Hotel after a review party. For the non-medicos amongst us, PFO is the official medical terminology for pissed and fell over. Paine was not simply walking down the stairs at Lloyd's, oh no. He was attempting a gymnastic feat with a difficulty factor of about 12 out of 10 if you're sober. As he discovered, it was bloody impossible when you're pissed. Finally, Springer said, and I quote, "I just loved him to bits. I learned so much from him, and I've not seen any other performer walk on stage and have the audience in stitches before they've ever said a word. He was pure funny." Now, those annual best of review and funny bits, Christmas parties, were also comedies in themselves. Paine proved that you didn't need a stage to get some of the most wonderful comedic performances. One memorable party at Andrew Coleraine's house in Newtown was catered by the roving roast people. We all pigged out on succulent meats and roasted veggies and beautiful chocolate pudding. We stuffed on the main course and lots of accompanying alcohol, so the pudding was barely touched. Now, about 4 a.m, it was time to wrap the party up. Paine and I both live in West Hobart and pre-arranged to share a taxi. But as a farewell gesture, I fashioned the most perfect turd out of the leftover chocolate pudding and put it in the butter dish in the Coleraine's fridge. Look, very childish, I know, but extremely funny when you're pissed, OK? Then I asked Coles if I could use the phone to call a cab. No worries, said Andrew. Phone's in the bedroom, but the missus is asleep. I'll be quiet, I said, tiptoed to the bedroom, called the cab and crept out again. Big mistake. In the hallway, the clowns had assembled for a comedy routine you couldn't simply script. I emerged. As I emerged, Paine shouted out for all to hear, Coleraine! Peebles just shat in your fridge, snuck into your bedroom, used your phone and rooted your missus. To which Coleraine replied, no worries, Paine, providing he left 40 cents for the phone call. And we're still laughing about that 25 years on. Look, prior to these best of and funny bits escapades, a few old knickers got together and we formed the Tasmanian Touring Review Company back in 1981. We threw in $100 each. Get us started. Damien Fuller built the most innovative touring box set I've ever seen with a sliding velvet curtain. Away we went. We actually had written a whole new show called A Night on the Box with parodies of contemporary television shows as our basis. And unlike the shows that followed, these were not simply rehashed old review material. They were quite innovative for the time. They had such clever references as, well, instead of pick a box, we had liquor box. Sorry. Instead of days of our wives, we had lays of our wives. Days of our lives, we had lays of our wives. And our countdown didn't have the first O in the title. After a couple of years, we stopped touring. Two reasons, actually. Firstly, we killed Damo's old Morris Nomad, which could no longer stand the strain of carting the set. Two lighting trees, 20 theatre lights, a dimmer rack, plus all the props. One of these props, actually, was our famous bum board, which was our take on a game show that had celebrity heads which contestants had to identify, open up and win a prize. Our equivalent had an audience member reaching through a hole in one of six celebrity bums. These included Gough Whitbum, Michael Hodgebum, and of course the Archbishop of Canterbury. Very funny until our final show, when the audience was probably not our intended demographic. I can't remember whether it was a Christian Women's Association or a Presbyterian Ladies Social Club, but suffice to say we made a hasty exit. We didn't receive our payment cheque that night, and sadly, in our haste, we left behind our precious bum board. And we never had the nerve to go back and claim it. Paine thought it was probably put to good use as a training aid for senior public servants being appointed by the incoming Liberal government. I seem to recall him suggesting that the bastards could use it for arse-licking practice. Look, when Graeme received his OAM, John X, Coles and others took great delight of adding the initials SOB to the honorific, making him Graeme Leslie Paine OAM SOB. Son of a bitch? Stupid old bastard. But Paine wasn't offended. He loved it. Graeme Leslie Paine, OAM, SOB, love him or not, you could never ignore him. Now he'll be stirring shit and making somebody laugh up there. Thanks, old mate. It's been a zany, crazy, fun-filled ride. Take a bow. Thank you.
Thank you, Daryl. Finally, Nick Paine will speak on behalf of the Paine children.
Hello. I'll keep this short, because you're all probably sick of hearing voices by now. I was tasked in putting together a little thing for Graeme's spoiled little shits, as he used to like to call us. We all had a lot of memories, so we only picked one each. I thought they're all pretty fitting. Chris's favourite memory of Dad was when Chris was younger, Dad was eating a bowl of green grapes and he wouldn't share any with Chris. Chris thought he was very clever by sneaking in and stealing one when Dad wasn't looking, and it turned out Dad knew that one was mouldy because he'd already put it in his mouth. And the Dad baited Chris into that the whole time. Ben told me about a story when Dad picked him and his drunk mates up at 4 a.m. once and was driving them all around the countryside, and they were so pissed they told him all the wrong house and didn't realise until they got to 7 Mile Beach that the house was actually in Moona. Graeme just sighed, looked at him and said, "That's your inheritance." Turned and drove them all back. Dad would always remind us that Ben was the only planned child and the rest of us were mistakes. We like to remind Graeme that we knew he'd only had sex 5 times, so that made sense. For me, Graeme and my bond has always been the Geelong Football Club. I remember when he first forced me to watch the football game when I was 7 years old. It was the 1995 Geelong Carlton Grand Final. It was my first game, and I remember sneaking out about 30 minutes in when Geelong were 40 points down and enjoying the afternoon playing computer games in his bedroom. I believe in that first 30 minutes, though, was the day I learned how to say, "fucking useless cunts." Imogen remembers Graeme for all the time she was in bands and singing in choirs, and he made sure he would attend every single one of the concerts. And Imogen always knew that she could find out how much he enjoyed the concerts by telling her how many people were on stage, because that means he was awake or not. Dad loved reminding Imogen that his worst birthday ever was when she was born, because he got no presents. And he had to spend the night at hospital, so because she was born at 4:05 a.m. But in the end, he got to go home and enjoy a lovely breakfast of sausage rolls and party pies. And finally, Matt. Matt's favourite memory of Dad is how Dad would always remind Matt he was the Stephen Bradbury of sperm. And how the builder and the computer technician and the astronaut fell away at the end, but you made it through. As Matt was the youngest, he was home later than everyone else. Dad would come home and trial every joke known to man on Matthew, and 99% of them were absolute bloody rubbish. So, personally, I want to thank Matthew, because, I mean, we didn't all have to hear this shit. He's the only one that had to take that one on board. Matt's fondest memory of Dad, though, is how he would go out of his way to run fundraising for people whenever they needed it, because he was such a selfless man. And finally, from all of us to you, Mum, but the fact that a turnout like this could happen is a testament to you, because you were the one behind the scenes looking after these bloody little shits. You're the shining light of the Paine family, and we owe you so much. And Dave would be so proud of everything you have done in the last few years for him and for us. On behalf of all of us, I'm sorry, nearly finished. I want to thank you all for the support you've given us throughout the last few weeks. Graeme would be incredibly humbled by the magnitude of the legacy he's left in us all, and for that we thank you.
Thank you, Nick. At this time, we have a photo montage of some of the happier moments in Graeme's life. Please take this opportunity to reflect on the man we have lost and the enormity of his contribution to all our lives.
troubles come, my heart burdened me. Then I am still waiting in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand.
And I acknowledge the incredible work of Justin Smith, who's unable to be here today, but who has from a million miles away, has managed to put together all these things and send them and bang them, and then they're on just on the screen. That's just wonderful. I'd like to invite the Glenorchy City Concert Brass to the stage. A warm welcome for them, please. They are going to quickly set themselves up into a V shape here in front of the screen, and we'll explain what's happening now. Graeme knew this place, of course, the Theatre Royal, as one of happiness, joy and laughter. And I think you'll all remember he was very much at home on this stage, milking every last laugh, cheer and round of applause. The Paine family have requested that from now on, and as you have been doing so far, you make as much noise as you like. Clap, cheer, laugh and cry, because we all know Graeme would have wanted it that way. And I think you all know that he would have been thrilled to see the Theatre Royal full today with lots of people, and what a wonderful testament that is to Graeme. In 2008, Graeme revelled in the opportunity to co-direct and perform in the Old Nick production of Brassed Off at the Mount Nelson Theatre. This show was produced in association with the Glenorchy City Concert Brass, co-directed by Graeme Richards, who's also unfortunately passed away. Graeme was also thrilled to be able to share the stage and the production with two of his children, Imogen and Nick. At the conclusion of the season, Graeme sent a DVD of the performance to the original writer of the show, who responded and made two interesting points. The first point was that Andrew Casey brought something special, something unique and incredible, to his role. And I'm sure that anyone who saw that show would agree. The second point was that Graeme's character seemed to use one particular word more than it had appeared in the original script. That word, in the Yorkshire accent, is, of course, fork! Thank you to Noel Hunt for that little anecdote. Please now give a warm welcome to members of the Glenorchy City Concert Brass who appeared in that show as the Grimley Colliery Band, performing one of the showstoppers from Brassed Off, Land of Hope and Glory. Gentlemen, please thank one more time the Glenorchy City Concert Brass. Graeme, everyone who knew Graeme knows that he absolutely loved that show and wanted to stage it again. Absolutely thought it was a real favourite, and it was a wonderful production at Mount Nelson. Those of us who worked with Graeme over the years will remember fondly the times he had a vision. One such vision prompted Graeme to approach longtime Union Review drummer Jeremy Simpson with the idea of having the whole cast drumming on wheelie bins. Both men agreed that the piece should culminate with Wipeout. So, ladies and gentlemen, We have an all-time favourite of Graham's. Sit back, relax and enjoy Jeremy Simpson, Graeme Paine and the Uni Review Wheelie Bin Tattoo.
Thank you.
will go on in my head forever. Ladies and gents, we've reached a significant moment in Tasmanian comedy history. Performing Tasmaniana for what I'm promised is the last time ever on the Theatre Royal stage, because Graeme would have wanted it. Please go wild for Ben and Nick Paine!
One nut! So I want to bend over and give him a cremorne. And I asked, do I play now or after I exit up? She said, now. I said, beauty, point me to the bedroom. But before I could pat Sonia, I see a straw on the floor with Lou in it.
Well, that sounds very snug.
Yep. He was up at plenty. And I didn't have to force it. My mate Wyvernhoed in, Henrietta, I donned a condom and went forth. Then she started to ooze. You should have heard the mole creak. But I'll tell you what, when I go rootin' in future, I'm going to use a lubricant.
Why's that?
Otherwise me cock will creak. Anyway, better be off. It's been a long day. Ta-ra, Leah.
I'll be seeing you, Arthur.
Right on, mate. Right on.
Say, Arthur.
Yep.
I think all your stories are bullshit.
I think you're right, mate.
Thank you, Ben and Nick. I'd now like to invite John Zintavalonis to the stage, who's going to share a tribute to Graeme. Welcome, John. I hope you feel at home up here.
Thanks, mate. Wow. I don't think I've cried so much, other than the moments I used to spend with Paine on tour with all the team and all the gang. What an extraordinary turnout for our mate, and what a great and very difficult some difficult acts to follow. I want to thank the Paine family. It's you survived, Graeme. Here, you're a beautiful, talented, big-hearted family, and thank you so much for allowing me or giving me the opportunity to honour Graeme up here very briefly. I know if Graeme was producing this, he'd be saying, fucking hurry up, it's costing us a fortune. But, yes, thank you, the Paines. You're such an extraordinary, beautiful bunch of people, and I include Graeme's illegitimate son, Zeb, in that. Someone said to me earlier, as I walked up, they said, what can you say that hasn't already been said? Well, there's a few things, but, you know, it's extraordinary just listening to all that stuff and seeing all that stuff up here. What an extraordinary individual Graeme was. And I just thought I'd just quickly, and I'll be as quick as I can, mention a few things that he instilled in me, apart from, my love of the review and teaching me how to deal with laughter and write a laugh and being so inspirational in my career. He instilled in me his love of cash. In recent years, I used to accuse him of being Greek. He, in one of our, one of the shows soon after he'd sort of retired himself from our touring show, he surprised us by turning up to the Claremont RSL, or was the hall, to see us do a fundraiser for some cheerleaders. We saw him leaning up against the wall. He had his walk. He would still get around at that point. It was a lovely surprise to have him there. We referred to him as the stupid old bastard. And the show finished, and by the time we could sort of pack up and get down and go and see the lady, he'd already beaten us to the lady with the money. Handed us our cash, only to find that he'd already taken his $100 royalty out of it. Which was fine by us, because none of us would have been there if it wasn't for him. He instilled in me my love of political incorrectness, inappropriateness and swearing. Graeme called me, I called him my stupid old bastard, and he called me his glick plick, which was his offensive way of saying Greek prick in an Asian accent. And he also gave me some... Well, there are only two bits of parental advice I've used and taken on board from friends when I had our first child. Cassie and I had our first child, Calliope. And I remember chatting to him one day saying we were having trouble with her. She's only 3 or 4 months old, and she'd go to bed and she'd wake up with an hour and she'd be crying. And we had to put her to bed and then a couple of hours she'd be crying. And he'd quickly tell me that he had none of that trouble with his children because he would lock them in the furthest room away from the lounge room and lock all the doors in between so he couldn't hear them. He would have loved this turnout today. He would have loved this show that we were doing at the moment. He would have been a part of it. And I'll miss him. I'll miss his guidance. I'll miss his advice. I'll miss his encouragement. I'll miss his ideas. I'll miss him getting up first thing in the morning on the Theatre Royal website, counting all the black dots and telling me how many seats I'd sold before the report would come through. Look, there's a lot more I could say about Graeme, but the show's not over yet, and what a bloody great show it has been today. But thank you all for coming and honouring our mate. It's been a tough few years, and you sort of... I know I don't deal with this sort of stuff too well. I deal with a lot of other stuff very well, but I'm going to miss him. But he'll be in my thoughts and heart forever. For as long as I step into a theatre, or do a joke, or write a laugh, or call someone a cunt, I'm going to miss you. I'm going to miss you, you stupid old bastard. You'll always be my stupid old bastard, and I will always be your glick pleek. Get fucked.
Thank you so much, John. And now, through the magic of theatre, between Tasmaniana and now, Graeme's favourite son, Ben, Graeme's favourite son, Ben, has miraculously taken up duck hunting and become afflicted with a condition where he says his own name in every word he speaks. He's also changed his name to Alf. I think I've got it all. Do I have it all? I think I've got it all. Ladies and gentlemen, because Graeme would have wanted it, please raise the roof for Alf!
Our foot, Balfoy, Ralph Over.
shout hot gal fun. Our fame? Balfang! Balfang! Yalf you! Gal hop the bow bastard! Now fetch rap over. Now fetch slap, please. Ralph over, Dow Five, Dow Thin, Dow Foo, Dow Piss, Dow Fiddle, Dow Fake. Dow Funny, Dow Foggy, Dow Paddles, Dow Foo, Dow Piss, Dow Fiddle, Dow Fake. Ralph Things, Dow Fack, Dow Fee, Dow Huck. Dow Foot, Dow Foy, Ralph over. Dow Foul. Dow Foo, Dow Funny, Dow Fick, Dow Fed. Dow Foo, Dow Hot. Dow Funny, Dow Fee, Dow Hull.
Welcome back, John X, and invite the delightful Andrew Coleraine and Colin Dean to the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, bye Ben. Ladies and gentlemen, magnificent croon. Please thank crew one more time. We've almost reached the end of today's proceedings, and you are all invited for drinks in the foyer bar followed by a wake at the Queen's Head Hotel in North Hobart. I'm sure that you all know that there's only one way Graeme would have wanted this show to end, and that is with the traditional uni review closing number. The lyrics, for those who don't know it or need reminding, are in your orders of service. The Paine family have requested that all guests sing along, and that those who know this piece sing as loudly and proudly as possible, as Graeme would have wanted it that way. At the conclusion of the closing number, I think the only fitting send-off and ending to today's ceremony would be a standing ovation for Graeme. The boys are going to start us off. Let's hope that... thank you, Uni Review, a traditional close.
And now we come to...